Thanks for joining us for the May 2017 edition of the Salem Connection. I'm your host, Casey Duncan, and for the next few minutes, I'll be connecting you to what's happening in your community. On May 8th, Salem City Council passed an ordinance that makes it easier for transportation network companies, like Uber or Lyft, to operate in the city of Salem. Transportation network companies, also known as ride-sharing companies, use mobile apps or websites to connect people in need of transportation with drivers providing transportation. Because ordinances go into effect 30 days after council approval, these companies can apply for a license on June 7th to allow their network of drivers to begin work within city limits. The Willamette Valley Communications Center, or WVCC, dispatches for 29 police, fire, and ambulance agencies in Marion, Polk, and Lincoln counties. In late May, WVCC completed testing and began offering text to 911 services. Text to 911 is now an option for residents with wireless devices who need emergency assistance but cannot communicate with a 911 dispatcher. The service will be extremely valuable to community members who are deaf, hard of hearing, or speech impaired, and those who are in a situation where verbal communication would endanger the individual. For more, we turn to Tony Collins, Salem's 911 call center operations manager.
The easiest benefit to see is if somebody is deaf, hard of hearing, or has some sort of difficulty speaking, they can text us and we can get their call now, versus before they would have to go through some kind of service or just have to kind of have a difficult conversation with us. It's much easier through text. As well as if somebody's in a very dangerous situation where they don't want the person that's in the room with them to know that they're calling 911, many times it's easier to text and you don't have to speak so that the person doesn't hear what you're saying. What you need to remember is there's going to be some questions that we asked you. The first question we're going to always ask you is, are you able to call us versus texting us? And it's a simple yes or no. If you're going to answer no, tell us why. I'm in a dangerous situation, or I'm deaf, or I can't speak. Something like that, and that'll get us off on the right foot with you so that we can handle your call appropriately. We're going to ask you a series of questions. What's the location of the emergency, which might be different than what your address is. You might not be at home, or you might be calling about something that's not at your house, even though you are home. So we'll ask you where the emergency is. And then we'll ask you what the emergency is, police, fire, or medical, and what's going on. And depending on what it is, there'll be a lot of questions we have about the incident. Because even though it's a text call versus a regular call, we still have to answer the normal questions so that you on that end of the text and us sending out the responders can all be safe. With our text to 911, what we're asking the public is only text if that's the only way you can get a hold of us. If you can call us, please do call us if it's safe for you to call, because it's much simpler and quicker for us to deal with the phone call. We can get through them much faster. The state mantra for text to 911 is call if you can, text if you can't.
As Tony reminded us, calling 911 in an emergency is still the preferred way to request help. Call if you can, text if you can't. However you reach out for help through 911, be prepared to tell the dispatcher your location and the nature of your emergency. This summer, things are also heating up at Salem's Mill Creek Corporate Center. Construction is now underway for two developments bringing jobs to Salem. The recently completed 186,000 square foot Henningsen cold storage facility will be joined by two new buildings totaling approximately 100,000 square feet for commercial and industrial tenants. For more, we catch up with Councilor Brad Nanke at the Mill Creek Corporate Center. Councilor Nanke represents Salem's Ward 3 and is Salem's longest serving councilor, currently in his fifth term.
We're out at the Mill Creek Corporate Center today, and speaking of three, we have our third development in the industrial park right now, the Henningsen cold storage facility. They have one other facility on the other side of town, connected up with NORPAC over there. This is phase one of what may be a four-phase development. They connect right up with a food processors process food. They do that very well. Henningsen cold stores and distributes. So it's logical that we might see here very soon a couple of food processors tying directly up to them. So when they're done processing their food, like at the NORPAC facility, they just drive through a doorway and boom, they're done. And then Henningsen does what they do. So looking forward to a lot more development out here. The first two developments are the Home Depot Rapid Deployment Center, fascinating facility full of conveyors that move between like 200 loading docks, and then the FedEx facility. The area is an urban renewal area. The urban renewal area fixes a tax base when you declare it an urban renewal district. In the case of this one, when we created it in 2005, that was $1 million. Today it's assessed at about $51 million. And so that frozen tax base, that $1 million, the taxes that are distributed off of that go to the school district, transit district, city of Salem. Anything above that has to be spent back inside of the urban renewal district. So when this is fully developed, we're looking at like $400 million of private investment, 5,000 jobs. So you can see what that tax increment will pay for out here. Our max indebtedness is $28 million. That's essentially going to road projects like here, Kubler Avenue, Almsville Highway, water, sewer. We converted about 76 acres of wetlands, mitigated that. So we are truly shovel ready. When it comes back out of urban renewal status, 15, 20 years, then that increase in value gets distributed back to all the taxing districts. The interesting thing is this was state property originally, so it provided zero taxes for property taxes. And this is one of the best type of urban renewal area sites that you can get. We have one other in the Fairview Industrial site that provided no taxes. So we have seven in town. Urban renewal dollars, increment financing has to stay inside of the district. It's a benefit over time. Looking forward to this one coming off. The Fairview Industrial Park is actually providing full distribution of taxes again. If you're ever concerned about urban renewal areas or how money is spent, come on down to council and give me a call and I'll help you out there as well. So again, beautiful day out here. Come on down, take a drive-by visit.
Projects of this scale could not be possible without the close collaboration of many city departments, as well as our external partners like SEDCOR, Oregon Department of Administrative Services, Portland General Electric, and Northwest Natural. With the Henningsen project, Salem has demonstrated that it can meet very aggressive development timelines. This success will help in attracting additional development to the Mill Creek Corporate Center. Thanks to the support of the Salem community, the city has begun preliminary work on the financing, property acquisition, and bid document preparation for project management and architectural services in order to move forward with a new public safety facility. Many months of due diligence and design work will be required before residents see construction activity. The present schedule calls for a move-in date of late 2020 or early 2021. At the May 22nd meeting of the City Council, Mayor Chuck Bennett expressed appreciation to Salem's voters for supporting the public safety facility bond measure. Let's listen in now.
And I'm going to just take a second to make a comment to thank the community for passing the police bond measure. It was a tremendous success. The entire election, certainly all credit to the chairs of the committee to pass the police bond, Jerry Frank and former Mayor Janet Taylor, as well as their tremendous team, and particularly to our police chief, Jerry Moore. We couldn't have done it without him. I think he did a fantastic job. We're all very, very pleased, and just can't thank the community enough for making this really enlightened and important change to the city's infrastructure. I think they're going to be pleased with the building, the location, the level of service it will engender from our police department, and we're all just very pleased.
As the school year nears a close, Salem Summer Reading Club begins Tuesday, June 6th. Prizes and fun activities on the Build a Better World summer theme encourage participants to find the joy of reading, increase confidence, and explore a variety of genres. Children of all ages can join the Summer Reading Club through the city's website or in person at the Salem Public Library on Liberty Street. This summer's calendar is busy in Salem parks and on Salem streets. On the first Saturday of each month at 8 a.m., you can join Salem's park ranger on a birdwatching tour of Minnow Brown Island Park. Splash pads in Salem's parks will be open when school closes for the summer. Join us in a celebration of Salem's Make Music Day on June 21st at venues throughout Salem. From the evening of Friday, June 23rd through Sunday, June 25th, Salem's got the beat. Come enjoy the 20th annual World Beat Festival, celebrating music and culture from across the globe. On June 29th, Salem's Public Works Big Toys take over Riverfront Park from 10:30 in the morning until 2 in the afternoon. Everyone is invited to learn about the big trucks and equipment that we use every day to keep our city clean, moving, and safe. Between now and then, join one of the $5 5K runs in Salem Parks. Register online for these events on our website. While on our website, check out the Movies in the Park schedule, beginning on July 8th around 9 p.m. with Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, and rounding out the season on August 26th at about 8 p.m. with Rogue One. This year's River Rock Concert Series starts Wednesday, July 12th. Check out the listings online. And on August 2nd, we permanently open the Peter Courtney Minto Island Bridge with a community celebration at 4:30 in the afternoon. This event will kick off the August 1st Wednesday events. The big solar eclipse will be turning out the lights in Salem at 10:17 a.m. on August 21st. TravelSalem.com features a variety of local events for eclipse viewers. On September 16th and 17th, Salem will host a River to Ridge run, paddle, and ride event. The following weekend, on September 23rd, Salem Open Streets will host an annual event. And for those looking for some post-summer fun, don't forget that October 1st is the Rotary Triathlon, and October 2nd, we celebrate the work of Salem's volunteers who make these and many other events possible. That concludes this edition of our show. Have ideas for future shows? Get in touch with us at manager@cityofsalem.net or 503-540-2426. You can find us on Facebook or Twitter, or get your City News Weekly by signing up for our electronic newsletter on our news page at cityofsalem.net. Thank you for joining us. We look forward to connecting with you next time on The Salem Connection.